السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. إن شاء الله we continue our reading from the book of Sahih al-Bukhari, the book of Jihad. And this setter is named, Bukhari named riding on the difficult horses, and which basically means those horses that are difficult to ride. And this hadith is narrated Anas ibn Malik. There was a field of fight in Medina, so the Prophet bought a horse called Mandub belonging to Abu Talha and mounted it. On his return, he said, I did not see anything of fright, and I found this horse very fast. تفضل يا شيخ، أنا انتهيت من الترجمة، بارك الله فيك. إن شاء الله brothers, the Sheikh will return in 1 minute. Just hold on a second. I think he's busy with something. He'll return back shortly. بارك الله فيك. السلام عليكم. First of all, before we start our lesson today, the Sheikh had a statement to say about an incident that he wanted to reflect upon. It was said on a discussion board online in a site called the Multaqa Ahl al-Hadith. It's a discussion board for those who study the Hadith and the sayings of Prophet alayhi wasallam, or this field of knowledge. What happened, there was somebody who posted something relating to the Sheikh al-Tarhouni, saying that he took the ijazah. We say that ijazah, it means a certification that a person takes from a sheikh or from a scholar, that he is certified in a certain field of ilm, a certain field of knowledge. Therefore, he said that sheikh took his certification in what he teaches, or in to be more specific, in the knowledge of hadith. He took it through something called through mail. What some scholars do, you send to the scholar an application that you receive certification, and he just sends it to you. He writes, you know, on a piece of paper, I certify this person for so and so and so, and you know, it's his signature, and you're certified from this specific scholar. So he said that Sheikh Tarhouni went through that, and he wants it, and he says that Sheikh Tarhouni why is it only from Book of Jihad, was not Sahih al-Bukhari, all of it. And then he put what the Sheikh has mentioned in his website, that the Sheikh, when he gives the ijazah, when he gives the certifications of whatever to people, he says the Sheikh, Hafidullah, put some hard conditions or hard obligations that the person has to go through before he gets a certification. First, says that, you know, that the Sheikh, you have to be, you go through a test, and you have to be known for that you see this knowledge, and you must have some sort of researches in that, and so forth. So the Sheikh answers his question saying that first of all, the Sheikh didn't take this certification easily, and he took it after he had distributed known publication. He had written known publications that was distributed and was sold in many libraries, and he was known for what he has written. Then he was able to get those certification. Why? Because he has the knowledge. He has proven that he has the knowledge through his books, through his researches. Then scholars can say, oh, now we can see that this sheikh, this scholar, he has enough information, he has enough knowledge, we'll give him this certification or this ijazah. So what happened? The Sheikh did not take through mail or anything, although this ijazah that he has, or this certification that he has, and through it he teaches us from Sahih Bukhari, was made for those who learn and study, and for those who has the capability of teaching such field, because he already learned it. For example, Sheikh Hamoud al-Tawajri, he never gave the Sheikh the ijazah or the certification until he looked and read his book, the book Sheikh Tarhouni, Ahkam al-Sifa, and when he liked the research, he gave him the certification. He liked the research methods that he used in the book, and what the kind of knowledge and information that Sheikh has shown in the book. And then he asked if he said, do you want the certification? He kind of gave it for him. It's not the Sheikh, but he went and asked, although the scholar, after he read it, you know, he said, wow, this guy has, the Sheikh, mashallah, he has knowledge, I will give him the certification. So that's what happened. It's not now. So he says, the brother who wrote this post, who's, know, not complaining, I don't want to say complaining, but he was asking why the Sheikh make it so hard. So first of all, we said it according to conditions, there are two. First, he was asking the ijaz that the Sheikh has on his website for those in knowledge of hadith or in the science of hadith overall, not only Sahih Bukhari. The Sheikh says there are two conditions. You must have some sort of researches and study in that field. Secondly, you have to go through a test. So, according to this test, it will show you have knowledges, if you have some sort of capability and information in this field, not. Because some people now think, you know, whoever gets the ijazah, he becomes a student of knowledge and becomes a sheikh and so forth. So this has to be, you know, when you're giving somebody certification, you have to know if this guy really has the information or not. You know, it wouldn't be so great if we just have so many people have certifications and they have nothing, they don't know anything of what they're talking about. Therefore, you may have the sheikh, those two conditions that he has put, so that when he certifies somebody, that someone has knowledge and deserves to have the certification. Otherwise, it won't be fair just to give anybody certification now or through something, or because he only heard the lesson. So, and they also said, why is it only from Sahih Bukhari, only the Book of Jihad? Why is not the whole Sahih Bukhari? And why do we have to be tested? The Sheikh says, if you want this certification and what we teach right now in the Book of Jihad, Sahih Bukhari, you have to go through that test. Otherwise, you won't get it. You know, it's not just coming and listening, that's great. But if you want to be certified in order to teach others, then you have to be tested to see how much knowledge have you gained through that. So we say, those who want the ijazah, those who want certification, he has to go through that test in order to achieve it. And inshallah, the Sheikh asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, pray Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that we inshallah may reach the full Sahih al-Bukhari in the future, inshallah. Jazakallah khairan, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you all. Tafadhal tarawih, inshallah. We return back to our explanation of the hadith, which was narrated Anas ibn Malik. It was a feeling of right in Medina, so the Prophet bore the horse called Mandu, belonged to Abu Talha, and anointed it. On his return, he said, I did not see any fright, and I found this horse very fat. The sector is called riding on difficult horses, and Al-Fahula from the horses, which means Al-Fahula means male horses. And this is a sector that Al-Bukhari named, and under it he put the hadith. This sector, or in this sector, the hadith that we have just mentioned. This, we say, that this also pertains to jihad, with the fact that the mujahid goes through difficulties in order to achieve such rank. The Prophet ﷺ has ridden a difficult horse, which means a horse that is difficult to ride on. You know, it gives you a hard time riding. So this shows how mujahid can go sometimes through difficulties in order to achieve such rank or a high goal. Bukhari mentioned also in the beginning or after the name of the sector, a saying of Rabi ibn Sa'd, who was from the Tabi'een. We know the Tabi'een are the Sahaba, and so come after them, and those who come after them, the three centuries after the Prophet ﷺ, or the Prophet ﷺ, 2 centuries after him. So he said a saying of Rashid Sa'd, who came after the Sahaba. You saw the Sahaba, but he did not see the Prophet ﷺ. So Rashid Sa'd said that the Salaf, he meant the Sahaba, and those who lived in his time, they used to like al-fuhul, they used to like the air horses. And that because two reasons. He said that the male horses, they run faster than the female horses, and they're more courageous in difficult times, and going through difficult routes, and fighting in different situations through the battles, they are more courageous and they're more stronger in doing so. After he said the name of the sector, and the saying of that, of Rashid ibn Sa'd have talked more than once about in Arabic. If you read it in Arabic, it says the Prophet ﷺ. Yes, when we translate, we say a horse, although we also say what kind of horse. When you say it in English, unfortunately, I personally believe English is a poor language, because if you say a horse, you would know what kind of horse is it. And the hadith is said faras. Faras, usually or in most occasions, it's called on female horses. Although on other occasions, it can be a horse. So according to Imam Bukhari, in what he has meant in the name of the sector, and from what we've seen, it's a mere horse, but also the Prophet ﷺ has praised this horse for its speed and its courage. And this that Imam Bukhari has mentioned, this comes, that we find, conclude for that certain things. first things that Mujahid goes through in order to actually perform jihad. This thing. Second is how the Sahaba and how the Prophet, the companions of the Prophet, how they have the science of jihad. What do we mean by science of jihad? Why? Because the female horses do the rahil, which is the sound of the horse, a particular sound that the horses sometimes make. This sound, the females, they rarely produce that sound. The male horses usually make it. Why? Because they show off their strength when they're fighting the battle. The female horses usually don't produce that sound. Therefore, the youth in split waves, if they're fighting at night, if they're hiding, if they want to do some sort of spying, they use female horses. If they're lining up in a battle, if they're trying to jump over fence, if they're trying to do any a difficult job, a battle, they would use the horses. The Sheikh said this had been in meaning and definition, it's not about horses. We can also conclude from that that Sahaba and the companions of the Prophet, they were clever, they were smart, they used the right thing at the right time, at the right place. So we should observe how clever they were in preparing things for battles and how to make methods to achieve their goals, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala know best. There is an addition that we'd like to add that Abi has mentioned before, that Al-Fuhula, or mentioned in the beginning, it's a horse that is used for intercourse with the females in order to produce other horses, and this is how it was done in the past. Unlike other horses who lack such things, they're not able to engage in intercourse with females because they don't have the reproductive organs or something of that sort, and they're considered to be on the female side. If we want to put it in kind, you put that sort of a male horse, it would be more towards a female horse. So when we say fushula in the deep Arabic meaning of that word, are those who are actually able for female to intercourse with the females, to produce other horses, and so forth. So we just wanted to add this a piece of information, which also will continue with our read. This next sector, that we start right now, is called Sector, the Shares of the Horse, narrated Ibn Umar, radiallahu anhu, Allah's Apostle, fixed two shares for the horse and one share for its rider, meaning from the war, booty, and no shares for more than one horse, and also what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, and He has created horses, mules, and donkeys for you to ride and use for show, and He has created other things from which you have nifl. This sector that we'll start, inshallah, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. As we said, the shares of the horse, narrated to Muhammad, as we said, Allah's Apostle takes two shares for the horse and one share for the rider. And meaning the shares that we talk about is shares that the owner or the knight, you know, of course, the knight is a soldier who fights over a horse after the war is over, the war booty, which means the leftovers from the war. If you're fighting and there are money or food or weapons or anything, all of those put together, and they are divided amongst those who are fighting. There are specific divisions that we won't go into right now, but what we're talking about is the division amongst those who are fighting over horse, amongst those knights. So we say overall, the knight gets three shares, two for the horse and one for himself. All right, so those shares that the owner of the horse receives, this hadith that Bukhari mentions of Ibn Umar, the horse has two shares, and for the owner, one share. So overall, this totals three shares. And the one soldier, if you're fighting by yourself, you're not over a horse or anything, you only get one share. This hadith that al-Bukhari brings, he also thought Malik has said. Malik, he mentions after the name of the sector, he said that Imam Malik said that also the horses al-Barazin, which we'll explain right now, they also get shares. Al-Barazin or al-Barazin, which is those horses who are not original Arabic horses, are horses that come from the Western lands. And Imam Malik said so according to the ayah that we have mentioned, which is in Surah An-Nahl. We have mentioned the ayah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in it, and He has created horses, mules, and donkeys for you to ride and use for show, and He has created other things for you for which you have no knowledge. So according to this ayah, now we have horses, we have donkeys, we have mules. Although Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not define, He said all horses. Since al-Durzaun, which are the horses who come from the western lands, are not original Arabic horses, or the horses who are a mix between original and authentic Arab horses and western horses, even if they're associated a horse, although they call a different thing in Arabic, as we said, al-Durzaun, so such horse is called al-Durzaun. So, he said also those kind of horses still get shares. And this is the scholars have agreed upon that the knight gets three shares, two for the horse and one for himself. Some scholars said that the horse gets one share and the fighter gets one share. But this is an opinion that is against the text. Now we have a saying of Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he says a knight overall gets three shares, right? This is what the hadith means. A horse gets two shares, and that over the horse gets one share. So that opinion cannot be really, it's not applicable because it's against us, we can't really use it. And the second, you know, that we can't raise an animal, or raise an animal a higher rank than a human and give him two shares. But we say, this text does not mean that we are raising an animal over a human, or giving him a higher rank. Although, if you think about it, the animal does not get the actual tangible share. You know, you don't go and go, oh, it's a donkey or the animal, oh, here's your share. You don't have it tangibly to him. Although what we mean is because the knight has to take care of his animal, has to take care of its needs, its wants, to have a shelter, to have food for it. So therefore it gets, you know, an animal, it's a bigger body, requires more needs and more wants. So it gets shares, and the knight actually fighter gets one share. But if you think about it overall, you're not raising an animal or paying an animal of a higher rank than a human. This is just because needs and wants may be more than a human want of food and shelter and so forth. And after all, we said the human is the one that receives the shares anyhow. So this opinion saying the horse only gets one and the human gets one is not really applicable, and it's against the text. Therefore, what the hadith mentioned, the knight gets one share and its horse gets the shares is the right thing. And inshallah, continue with our explanation. Also, have in this right. This hadith has been used as a proof if a mushrik fights along with the Muslims, if a mushrik fights along with the Muslims, for example, al-Shabi, and he's from the Tabi'in, as we have mentioned before, those who come after the Sahaba, and he said that the mushrik falls under this heath. Although this, again, is the rest or the majority of the scholars, and this hadith pertains only to the Muslim fighter. And even if the Muslim fights fights with Muslims, as I have mentioned before about his assistance from Mushrikeen, he's given some sort of incentive for what he has done. Although he does not receive, he gets an incentive or something that he gets, such a, like the women and so forth, but he does not get a share like the Muslim fighter. So he does not get the same rank. And using this hadith as a proof on such opinion, is not right, and this against the majority of the scholars. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. And this al-Bukhari said, the sector of the one who has used someone else's right in the battle, narrated Abu Ishaq, somebody asked al-Bar ibn Azib, did you flee deserting the apostle during the battle of Hunayn? Al-Bara replied, but Allah's apostle did not flee. The people of the tribe of Hawazin were good archers. When we met them, we attacked them, and they fled. When the Muslims started collecting the war booty, the pagans seized us with arrows, but Allah's apostle did not flee. No doubt, I saw him on his white mule, and Abu Sufyan was holding its reins, and the Prophet was saying, I am the Prophet in truth, and the son of Abu Talib. Al-Bukhari had said to the second, the one who has used someone else's right in the battle, we said, narrated Abu Ishaq, somebody asked Al-Bara ibn Azib, did you feel deserting Allah's apostle during the battle of Hunayn? Al-Bara replied, but Allah's apostle did not flee. The people of the tribe of Hawazin with the archers. When we met them, we attacked them and they fled. When the Muslims started collecting the war booty, the pagans' faces with arrows, that was the Prophet did not flee. No doubt, I saw him in his white mule, and Abu Sufyan was holding its reins, and the Prophet was saying, I'm the Prophet in truth, I'm the son of Abdul Muttalib. The hadith falls under the behavior of the Mujahideen and their assistance between each other. And here is the one who has ridden his brother's right during the battle because he might need, even if it's not his horse. This all falls under the category. Whoever used his brother's weapon or his colleagues or his fellow soldier during a battle, he used his weapon, he used his ride or his tank or his battleship, whatever. This all falls under this title that we mentioned, the sect of Bukhari has mentioned in the book of Jihad. In this hadith of Bara ibn Azb, Al-Imam Bukhari mentioned a part of this hadith, but not the full narration. And that person comes, that somebody who asked Bara ibn Azb, did you flee deserting Allah's apostasy in the battle of Hain? It was in sort of blaming for such incident. So Bara answered in a magnificent manner that, how he, in his answer, he praises the Prophet, that the Prophet never flee, even though there was those who flee, although there was him, peace be upon him. And then he apologized for those who ran away, mentioning that Hamazin were strong fighters, also they were known that they were good archers. Some tribes are known for a specific skill, and that was the skill that Hamazin were known for, they were good archers. So he mentioned the fact that they were good archers, and the tribe of Hamazin, with those from whom the Prophet ﷺ fought during Hunayn, the Battle of Hunayn, and they were known for such skill during the battle. What happened was that the Muslims, during the fighting, they started fighting very hard to the point that it seemed that Hawazin has lost. And then they went after to look for the war booty, just like happened during Uhud. Those archers, the Muslim archers, were on the top of the mountain. After they saw the mushrikeen, after they saw the pagans leaving, they went down to collect the war booty without an order from the Prophet, even though he first ordered them to stay up there. So what happened, some of the companions went to collect the war booty. And in the seerah, in some of the stories in the seerah, some of the books, we say that the loss of Hawazin in front of the Muslims, it was a trap. To get the Muslim in the valley between two mountains and in order to drag them, there was another group of Hawazin awaiting the Muslims to fight them. Therefore, he said that some of the companions flee because of what has happened in the atmosphere. They were trapped and everything was coming at them. And this is just how worrying about life may cause a downfall during the fighting. So while fighting, which is one and only one thing in your mind, think about the battle and fighting and wait for the leader's order. If he wasn't the call leader, otherwise you should not get carried away by other things, especially if it's a life type of material. And also it pertains, this hadith also pertains what proofs that the companions were humans. Some of them got carried away, some of them and that's a human characteristic, it's in all human beings. But the Prophet ﷺ, he stood strong in such a moment with a little amount of companions who were strong enough to fight the desires and fight any other and to fight fears, and he stood around them. And this such incident that was mentioned, the Prophet ﷺ, he was on the mule, and as I said in the hadith, it was a white mule. And Abu Sufyan, we mean Abu Sufyan right here is Abu Sufyan ibn Abi Harith ibn Abdul Muttalib, and he's holding the reins of that mule. And he said it out loud, Prophet ﷺ said it out loud, what we have mentioned in the hadith, I am the Prophet in truth, I am the son of Abdul Muttalib. And he said it this out loud to make sure the Muslim fighters know to sit around, so there he's not free. And send fear in the hearts of those pagans that he is fighting, tell them, I'm courageous, I'm not afraid to fight, I'm right there, I'm calling out loud that I'm right here, if you're strong enough, come fight. So this is what we benefit from, and this is the knowledge that we gain from such hadith. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. This sector, as Al-Bukhari has mentioned, this next sector that we go in right now, is a sector that is called the sector of writing, and putting the feet in the stirrup. Narrated Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, when the Prophet put his feet in the stirrup and the female camel got up carrying him, he would start reciting Al-Diya at the risk of Dhul-Hulayl, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. Those or these next sectors that we'll be talking about are relating to what gets or what's used on the horses or on the camels during the fighting and during jihad, and I'm talking about stirrups, and those devices are used in order to put your feet in when you're riding on a horse or a camel. So pretty much there are some sort of gear that is being put on the horse or on the camel in order that you on and put your feet in, so you are in some sort of a stabilized manner when you're riding the camel, you won't fall off. With the horse, of course. And here, he mentions the name of the sector that he says the stirrups of the ride, and he mentions two of them. He mentions al-rikab, and he mentions al-raz. This is in Arabic, and I'll translate that right now. Al-raz usually is for the camel, that's what some people said, is the name of that device, that gear that is yours for the camel. And al-rikab, as some scholars said, is for the horse. This incident was during or around the Hajj that this hadith was about. And we said that the Prophet put his feet in the stirrup and the camel got up carrying him and he would come by the mosque of Dhul-Hulayfa. So, he put his feet, the Prophet, in the stirrup. And as we said, this proves that this hadith proves that what the Prophet was riding was a camel, because the hadith used the word al-gharz. So, which proves the Prophet was riding a camel or a female camel. And the Prophet, he will come by the mosque of Dhul-Hulayfa, and it's an area away from Medina, now by a few kilometers. And it was the time place is known by Abiyari, and it was used to determine the timing of the Hajj. And it also means the Prophet had, we can benefit from the hadith that we say the Prophet had a stirrup for his camel. And this hadith also proves that the Prophet, or this hadith was used, was brought in because some people said from the Salaf that the Prophet used to cut that stirrup from the horses. But we say this hadith is used to show that such incident, the Prophet would cut the stirrup is because it was training, not because it was forbidden, although it was used for training. So the actual act is not forbidden. The actual act of putting your feet, using it, is not forbidden. You can use it. Although Prophet would, if you cut it, that's because in order to develop a skill, and it's for training and practicing, and also best from the hadith that the development of skills and training of battle weapons and rides is very important in order to be able to perform jihad on many, many ways and on many different rides. You don't need to, oh wait, I did not prepare for this. No, you're already prepared. You have the skill, you have the talent. And this is some sort of preparation Muslims are obligated to go through if they're willing to be from the mujahideen. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. This next sector is called riding an unsaddled horse. Narrated Anas radiallahu anhu, the Prophet met them, meaning the people, who was riding an unsaddled horse with his sword flung over his shoulder. This actor, Imam Bukhari, mentioned the saddle that the knight would sit on. And those who does not use a saddle are usually those who are capable of doing so, because it needs a tremendous amount of skills that a person would have in order to ride a horse without a saddle. And this shows how the Prophet ﷺ had this tremendous skill in actually riding that horse with no saddle on. And it's such a difficult thing that those who are capable, are very capable on horseback riding, is not an easy thing. Usually, even those who are, you see now those who go on competitions and so forth, still use that saddle. So, mentioning that the Prophet ﷺ had no title on. It just shows how skillful he was in riding that horse, or riding horses in general. And also, we can prove, or this hadith can be a proof for the hadith that we have mentioned before. There was another hadith that we have mentioned before, narrated Anas ibn Malik, who was feeling of fright in Medina. So the Prophet ﷺ bore the horse called Mandu, belonging to Abu Talha, and mounted it. And when he said, "I did not see," when he said, "I did not see anything of fright, and I found this horse very fast." We can connect this hadith to that. This hadith to the hadith which we are talking about right now. The Prophet ﷺ, he met people when he was coming back that was riding an unsaddled horse with his sword. It was slung or was put around the neck of the horse. So when we make a connection between two hadith, between the two of them, we can find something. We can tell here that the Prophet ﷺ, we can take that the Prophet ﷺ, when he was in a hurry and he wanted to go very fast, he had no time. He had no time to look for a saddle. And this from the wisdom from the Prophet ﷺ. And it takes from him, it can take from such incident that the Prophet ﷺ, he can hurry in getting, in getting a new, or compete, or in other words, he compete with time in order to achieve a certain goal that he has, or he wants, or he needs to find out something, or he has no time to waste. At that point, there was a fright, there was a feeling of fright. He wanted to know what's going on around Medina. So after Salam, he was the most courageous. He wanted to go fast. He had no time, place to get saddles or so forth. He jumped on the horse and he'd run very fast. And this shows that now the trail of the Prophet Salam used to go through, and the companions would also go through, and that the Mujahid needs to go through such training and such skill, because you're put in such circumstances that you need to face anything, and you don't know what is coming at you. So we need to be able to be ready in such incidents. And we mentioned also those who ride cars with crazy manners. You go very fast. Is voice clear? Those who fight. Okay. Zakumullah khairan. We mentioned those who ride cars, with crazy manners and fast speeds, and they make sharp turns. They go crazy about driving the cars, and then they make tawbah, they stop doing so because, they may think it's fun, but when they hit somebody, then the fun is over. So when we mention this incident, we say that sometimes the police actually use those people after they stop this bad habit, and they make tawbah, they turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they use them as chasers. For those who fight, for those who actually do it for fun, and they're playing around, and they say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not made Allah with tawbah and so forth. So those who were or used to it can be used. So we say that a mujahid, if you have a certain skill, this can be used for jihad. It can be used for jihad. And a mujahid also usually strives to get new skills and new any sort of new way to do things. If you're trying to be a mujahid and you pray Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala want to be a mujahid, use all your skills, use all your devices and all your ways, be a mujahid. So we say that the Prophet used his training, used his wisdom in order to reach out in Medina and find out what was frightening, even though he had no saddle on, which shows how skillful he was, the Prophet ﷺ. The hadith that we mentioned of the sector that we'll be talking about is about the soul horse. And this hadith that we will be talking about, that narrated Anas ibn Malik, and we have mentioned before, once the people of Medina were frightened, so the Prophet ﷺ rode the horse belonging to Abu Talha, and it ran slowly, was of narrow paces. When he returned, he said, "I found your horse be fast." After that, the horse could not be surpassed in running. And this hadith has been mentioned in several times in this book of Jihad, and we have mentioned several times. And we have said before that Al-Bukhari would use hadith in different places because it has several proofs on things, or it has it talks about several points several points in fiqh al-jihad, science of jihad. So we mentioned it in the sector about courage, or a sector about something else. So we would use a hadith that has many points, and he would point out the one point that he wants to, or that he is mentioning right now. For example, now he's mentioning the fact about slow horses. So he mentioned the part about slow horses. He's talking about courage. He put part about courage. And this is from the knowledge of Al-Bukhari, of Al-Bukhari, and how much knowledge and information that he had. We talked about, in this sector, he named it Al-Faras Al-Qatuf, meaning the horse or the slow horse. And we say the Qatuf, it's an Arabic word, which means the horse that has small steps or narrow paces. And the linguistic scholars, or the language scholars, they have other words, for example, Qamus, and we have Qatuf, and so forth. They're all names of how a horse would run in a way or manner. As we said, Qatuf is the one that has small steps or narrow paces. Qamus would be the one that runs with its back in a certain shape, that it twists its back in a certain shape or a certain manner. So all the linguistic scholars had certain names of how the horses would run. And we find the Prophet ﷺ had no time for picking and choosing. There's a fight in Medina, and there's a possibility of an enemy around Medina. I need a horse. Any horse will be in front of me, I'll take and ride it. You know, I'm not going to waste time over which horse is the fastest and picking and choosing. So it wasn't the time of picking and choosing. And from the blessing of the Prophet ﷺ, Allah has given him from benefit, it became very fast. And even afterwards, it was the fastest of all rides, the fastest of all horses around. And this is also proof that the Prophet ﷺ has blessings, that whatever he touches or whatever touches him, ﷺ, is blessed, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. JazakAllah khairan all, and thank you for listening to the lecture today. The lecture has, the lesson is over, and now is a question and answer session. Whoever has questions in jihad, the questions of jihad will be answered first. So if you have any question of jihad, you go on first, and then after the session of questions and answers in jihad is over, then there's a general session. So inshallah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whoever has a question in today's lesson or jihad in general, can go ahead and ask the Shaykh inshallah.